This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It's wonderful to have you here, gathered here in the Lord's house as we begin worship this day. And it's the first Sunday of the month, so rightfully so, we celebrate the sacraments of communion. And is there anybody that has not received communion elements that we'll do, we will partake of at that point in the service? If you have not, please raise your hand and an usher would be happy to get you one. Well, it looks like the ushers did a great job. Thank you. Always a reminder, take a look at the bulletin, see what's going on in the life of the church. And we have our Wednesday nights starting again this Wednesday evening. Supper at 5 o'clock, and then Bible study and choir, or our choir at 6 o'clock. The Bible study will be in here this week, and we may move it after that, but we will start in here comfortably. And I'm going to be doing a study on Colossians. That was like a hybrid of Colossians and Galatians. Colossians, and a study on going against the tide of culture. At one point, you know, most of you grew up in a time we would call Christendom. Well, we no longer live in that. The West is very secular now, and Christianity is counter to the culture. You know, you used to talk about the hippies and whatnot being counterculture. Christianity is now counterculture. And so we're going to talk about going against the tide of culture as Christians and what it means to be Christian in a changing world. And so that'll start this Wednesday night. And of course, all are welcome to that. And if you don't come to dinner, just come to Bible study, or of course, come to choir 6 o'clock in the choir room. It's directly across from me. If you don't know where the choir room is, somebody will show you, but it's directly across the courtyard. But it's wonderful to have you all here in worship. Let's go ahead and bow our heads as we gather for worship this morning. Gracious and loving God, may a spirit of love, of peace, of reconciliation come over this place by the power of your Spirit. We claim this time for you, O God, a time to spend in prayer, in study, in fellowship, in praise. Lord, may your blessing be upon us as we gather together as the community of the faithful. We pray that this time would be set aside for something so sacred, to worship you. And then as we leave, God, hope, we pray that we would be inspired to spend time with you, enjoying life with you. Gracious God, thank you for the opportunity to worship you, to give thanks for what you did upon the cross. Because you live, we also may live. We give thanks this day, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, if you're able, I invite you to join with me in the call to worship. Great indeed, we confess, is the mystery of our faith.
God was manifested in the flesh, vindicated in the spirit, seen by angels, believed on in the world, taken up in glory.
We have gathered in his presence, the ecclesia, the church, for God's glory.
We have a calling which goes beyond understanding, a calling that is not of this world. We are here to be renewed in faith as we worship God.
Let us worship him with pure hearts. Amen.
Amen. Please stand if you're able while we sing "Morning Has Broken."
Praise for the singing, praise for the morning.
seated.
And as we continue in worship, we confess our sins both collectively as the body and then individually. Please join with me in this confession of sin. Lord, though you should guide us, we inform ourselves. Though you should rule us, we control ourselves. Though you should fulfill us, we console ourselves. We think your truth too high, your will too hard, your power too remote, your love too free, but they are not. And without them, we are of all people most miserable. Gracious Father, you created the world and declared it good, but the creation has been frustrated by our brokenness. We have not sought your face, but our own glory. We have not taken care of your creation, but continued to try and destroy. O God, turn our hearts to your call to love and nurture a world broken by trespasses and sin. Amen. Now, friends, let those words wash over you as you spend a moment personally offering your hearts in repentance to God. Friends, we may try to rule ourselves by fear, but Christ is the strength to meet our fears. I declare to you, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
The peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And also with you.
I'd also like to invite any of the children if they want to head back for children's church.
Adore you. rolling rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Wonder at the mention of your name, Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery.
Gotten to the sermon so quickly. I know some of you are thinking, oh, we're going to beat the Baptists to breakfast. Ah, ha ha ha. Back in 2007, I just turned 31, and before I get into that, I want to just bring up this topic of our bodies. We know our bodies are important, but yet, as Christians, somehow we often put them to the side as if they don't matter that much. But our physical bodies house the Spirit of God, which indwells within us. And so, that's where we start today, about the importance of our bodies. So I had just turned 31. My health was never bad. I was always a big kid. I grew up in a family that was not really big, but I was big. And I probably, my health was good because I was relatively young. But I remember on March 20th, 2007, my father was visiting me when I was living in Dumas, Texas. He wanted Chinese. I wanted Chinese. I got him some, and I had a healthy shake that night. And it began the first start of a long journey, which I'm still on. Now nearly 15 years on. I started exercising, jogging, which turned to running, and I found out I really don't like that. And then I started lifting weights. I had always been big, but I wasn't strong. I wanted to be strong. So I went from somebody who was, really, I'd become just a typical sedentary American, to somebody who works out 5 to 7 times a week. And as I began the journey of getting into better shape, I really began to ask the question, like, where does God fit into all this? And the more I started thinking and dwelling and praying and studying and researching, I sat here thinking, we're missing something big time in our faith as Christians. And I started to reflect on the connection between our spiritual health and our physical health, and how having a healthy temple, the body, can be part of having a healthy spiritual life. Now, I come to this with this disclaimer. All of us are different. Our bodies are all different. We all have different genetics. Some are born to be tall. Some are born to not be tall. Some just have bigger frames. Some have a small frame. If you look at my mother, you're often surprised that she birthed this. Because, and I was a big baby. We're just built differently. But as we think about that, what does it look like for us to be the healthiest version of ourselves? We talk about that spiritually, being spiritually healthy, but what does that look like to be physically healthy? We think about it spiritually, about growing in our faith, exercising our faith. We open our Bibles, hopefully read it. We stop and we pray. And we worship, and then maybe we fellowship with a Christian and we seek godly counsel. Wouldn't we say those are things that strengthen our spiritual bodies? Yes. So what do we do to strengthen and make our physical bodies healthier? Well, I want to read some words from the Apostle Paul this day, from his first letter to the church at Corinth, starting chapter 6, verse 19. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, meaning the Spirit is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. This is the word of God for the people of God this day. Thanks be to God. So all of us know we need to take care of ourselves. We all know that, and we can make lots of jokes about getting older, and a part of our body will hurt, and we'll think, I didn't know something existed in that part of the body, right? And you feel a pain. And you know the phrase, youth is wasted on the young? Oh yeah. I was in the gym the other day talking to this gal who is a bodybuilder, a little bit older than me, still chiseled, has, you know, been working on her frame, her body, for probably 35 years lifting. And we look at some of the way the young people, especially the men, lift, and we think, oh, if they only had half a clue. Because we talk about, you know, somebody else, some of the things they do, these young guys, and lift in the gym, and they'll hurt themselves, and they're fine 48 hours later. And they'll say, Ben, you can do that. And I say, yeah, I can, but it's going to hurt for 6 weeks. Right? You know, amen? Amen. Amen. So what does it look like to start treating our bodies like the temple of God? You know, most of the times we don't internalize the truth. We don't focus on what Paul is saying. We don't apply it. We don't live in it. As Paul says, don't you know that the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who indwells in you, whom you have from God? You are not your own. You don't belong to yourself. For you were bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and your spirit. Your body and your spirit, which are God's, which belong to God. Okay, so we can get our mind around this. We understand this as Christians, that as a people of faith, the Spirit indwells within us. We read that all the time throughout the Scripture. But what Paul is saying, don't you realize, though, your bodies are important. Now, we have to backtrack a little bit into what's going on in Corinthians, or in Corinth, and what he's writing about in Corinthians, because he's dealing with a lot of sexual idolatry here in this letter, and specifically actually in this chapter of 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Corinth was a very pagan city, and people would go to have sex with the priestesses at the temple. And so Paul is talking about their bodies being important. Because people say, oh, my soul is washed clean. It doesn't matter what happens with my body. We act that way sometimes as Christians, don't we? And I don't mean that you out are going to Corinth and having sex with the priestesses. I don't mean that necessarily. I don't think Corinth still has that going on. But it would have quite the travel trade if it did. But that's not what I'm talking about. We often, though, discard our bodies and don't think about it. But he's saying, don't you realize your body is important? Because one of the things in Greek culture that Paul is dealing with is Paul is dealing with the pagan notion that the spirit is what matters, our bodies matter little. That it doesn't matter. Well, that was anathema to his Hebraic upbringing. You see, you can always see that God's no fool. You can always, hindsight's always 20/20. And you can see how the Hebraic notion that the soul and the body are connected, that they are important, they are both interconnected, that you have that body, God gave it to you, take care of it. And Paul was born in that world and also in his Greek world because he was also Greek, a Hebrew of Hebrews, but yet he had the pagan Greek background too. And so he's trying to say, listen, our bodies are important. Don't you know that your body is what houses the temple of God? And so he's saying we must also remember how it got there by the cross of Christ. You were bought and sold for a price, and you do not belong to yourself. And this is what gives our bodies even greater value for what Christ did for us. Because God literally indwells and lives within you. Proverbs 23, 1 and 2 says, when you sit down to eat with the ruler, consider carefully what is before you and put a knife to your throat if you are a man given to appetite. The wisdom literature often makes you go, When you sit down to eat with the ruler, consider carefully what is before you and put a knife to your throat if you're a man given to appetite. It's saying, watch what you value. Take care of yourself. And then later on in that chapter, hear my son and be wise and guide your heart in the way. Do not mix with wine bibbers or with gluttonous eaters of meat. For the drunkard and the glutton will come to poverty and drowsiness will clothe a man with rags. What do you do with something like that? Is it saying that we're not supposed to have wine? Well, the Baptist might say that. And are we not supposed to eat meat? Well, some of our Seventh-day Adventist brothers might say that. But no, it's talking about how you live your life. Do you live as if it doesn't matter? Do you just do whatever you want? Or do you live your life focused on being a child of God? Because clearly the Word speaks to us taking care of our bodies. We need to know that. And the sooner the better. We don't want to be like this. I read this guy who was 98 said, if I'd have known I was going to live this long, I would have taken better care of myself. Well, something was working right. The National Institutes of Health, NIH, estimates that 2/3 of Americans are overweight. That doesn't surprise me. It means over 135 million Americans are. Eating too much, as we know, is normal to most of us. It's normal for me. I feel like this man, Stephen Shepherd, he was talking to his doctor. He went in for a checkup, and the doctor asked him, have you been living a normal life? And he said, yes, doctor. And the doctor said, well, you need to cut it out then. It's almost like it's from wisdom literature. I often look at things. I try to do it kind of the 80-20 rule. Try to be smart with my eating 80% of the time. And then 20% of the time, Taco Bell and I are friends. This is a question to ask of each and every one of us. We're all different. Like I said, this isn't to shame anybody or anything. You know, I make jokes often, and this is something that my body always wants to be big. My body, I am always hungry. The only time I can ever remember not being hungry was last year in the first bout of COVID I had. Because it would be like 11 o'clock at night and I'd be making myself a quesadilla and I'd think, oh, I didn't eat dinner. I forgot to eat dinner. And I think, I forgot to eat lunch. And I was like, I've lost 17 pounds today. I always, when I get the flu, can I get like a Big Mac? I'm always hungry. But I couldn't taste it, and I could not smell it. I'd be sitting there with garlic, and I'm like, what's wrong with this garlic? Is it old? Because I couldn't, you can always smell garlic, but I couldn't smell it at all. But all that to say is, what are you doing in your own life to think about the temple that houses the Holy Spirit? How much money do you think Americans spend a year on losing weight? $60 billion. $60 billion. Not working out for us too well as Americans. And, you know, we love our stimulants. How many of you love coffee? I don't judge you. Fair amount of you. How many of you love caffeine? If I had more hands, I'd put more up. I read this. You know you're drinking too much coffee when you answer the door before people knock. I think some younger people wouldn't know this, but you'll all know this, when Juan Valdez names his donkey after you. Remember that? Of course you do. When you can play ping pong without a partner. When you can chew other people's fingernails, and you can jumpstart your car without cables. There was this meme, you know, like a picture with words you see on the internet. And it showed like this crazy looking lizard with these odd colored eyes. And I had this guy that I used to work out with in Casa Grande, a big guy. He would come in and he would put two scoops of this pre-workout in, like a pre-workout stimulant. And the two equaled about 400 milligrams of caffeine. And then, I was very entertained by this. And then he wouldn't take a bottle of water and fill it up. He would take an energy drink and use that. And I said, how's your blood pressure? He said, well, my doctor says that it's kind of high. No. But this meme was this crazy looking lizard with these odd colors, or the colorful eyes, and it just said, I can smell colors with this much caffeine. You know, it's just one of those stimulants. Some of us love sweets. How many of you are a sweet lover? Sugar? Sugar's your thing? Your drug of choice? Someone once said that a balanced diet was a cookie in both hands. But it's like this, you may have heard this, brain cells come and brain cells go, but fat cells live forever. I make jokes, because we all know the reality of this. And sometimes, you know, we can be, you know, seem like we're healthy, and then we get blood work done, and our blood work is not healthy. I said that to my mom once. She said, I had my blood work done. I said, I want to see it. And I said, oh, Mom, you're lucky. You're small. Your blood work shows inside, you're not small. You know, because blood work can show sometimes that even you think you're healthy, because you look healthy physically, you're not necessarily, kind of like spiritually. So where this starts is habit stacking. It's beginning to think, you know, one of the problems we have, it's like on January 1st, we start off, you know, raring to go, and we know it's hard to keep it up. We know it's hard to keep it up. Paul says in 1 Timothy, for physical training is of value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. That things are good for us. One day George said, he said, there's nothing like getting up at 6 in the morning, going for a run around the park and taking a brisk shower before breakfast. And his friend said, how long have you been doing this? And he said, I start tomorrow. All this to say, it's one of those, it's like when you're a kid, when your parents say, eat your Brussels sprouts. You know, my father grew up pretty poor, and I never met a man who could eat literally anything put in front of him and wouldn't complain. It didn't matter. Then finally, years ago, my brothers and I would prod him, there's got to be something you don't care for. There's got to be something you want, because he literally would eat anything. And I ate his mother's food one time when I was a small child, and I understood that now he would eat anything after eating that. She was not the cook that my mother's mother was, the German was. But he said, fine, I'll tell you if you stop talking to me. Okay. I really don't care for Brussels sprouts. But you know the whole thing, eat your Brussels sprouts. We kind of look sometimes at doing healthy things like that, don't we? Like the idea of exercise and whatnot. Well, it comes down to the habit stacking we talked about a few months ago, and I understand that. When I started exercising years ago, I was like, I'm going to run down the street. I made it past the next house, and I thought, oh, this is really awful. And then I started walking. But then I kept doing it more and more, and I fell in love with it. Not so much running or jogging or walking, but I fell in love with movement, with exercise, with fitness, because it had to become a journey, not a destination. I fell in love with it. And we can talk all day about the best exercises, you know, and I can write a regimen for you of things that would be good for you. But people, when they say, what's the best exercise? And I will always say the same response, the one you will do. If you like swimming laps, I can't stand it. A pool is for me to sit in. It's hot, and to me, that's just, I want to stand there. I don't want to do laps. Some people love it. Great. Well, I like to walk. Then walk. I like to garden? Garden. But what are we doing in terms of reflecting of what it means to take care of the temple God has given to us? Christian psychiatrist David Larson spent 15 years researching how Christian commitment affects mental and physical health. And what he found really shocked him. And you may have heard this. Regular churchgoers live longer. You may have heard that. Less incidence of heart attack, arteriosclerosis, and also less blood pressure issues. The Albert Institute once reported that active church members have a 60% less chance of a heart attack. Active church members have a 55% less chance of a one-car accident. So if you love Jesus, apparently you're not going to get in a wreck as easily. And active church members live an average of 5.7 years longer. Only 30% of people strongly opposed to church say they are very happy. Means 70% said they were not. But 70% of highly committed Christians said they are very happy. Godliness is profitable in all things, Paul says, having the promise of the life that now is and which is to come. But what is godliness? One preacher gave this summary. Godliness is the knowledge of God in the mind, the grace of God in the soul, the love of God in the heart, and the obedience to God in the life going forward. We know we all need that. We all need to have that in our lives. So what does it look like for you as we reflect on that, the body being a temple? What does it look like for you? Early in COVID, a year and a half ago, I remember being very, very frustrated at the way we were handling it. And I don't mean because information came out that would say, do this or don't do this. Not so much that. What really frustrated me early on, and I didn't understand, but I think it's because we were very ignorant to it, is that you saw right away people, especially middle-aged and younger, if they were physically healthy, if they got COVID, they got over it most of the time very quickly. Not all the time. And the thing is, spending years studying nutrition, exercise, whatnot, one of the things we found that markers for health, like if you have blood issues, blood glucose issues, like diabetes, whatnot, we can change markers in as little as like 3 days by walking. And government was shutting things down and telling people, go inside, have a bake-off. Well, I like that. I like it when people bake for me. I'll eat it. Sure, I love it. But they weren't saying, get outside and walk. Sometimes they were. Our governor here did, actually said, get out, move, exercise. But I saw that and I thought, we're different. In the last 100 years, as we know, everything's changed. Our bodies don't like to lose weight, right? Because for thousands of years, food was often scarce. And so our bodies adapted to not, so our bodies want to hoard. I understand that. In a nuclear winter, I will do well. I will. But what does it look like for us? What does it look like for you personally? To reflect on your own health, or what can you do in your own life to start working on your own temple? And it was interesting, as I began to study years ago about physical health in our faith, the theological aspect of it, and that's where some of this with Carol Story, who came to me to talk about the FAN program, that's where a lot of this came from, was this question of our faith. It's amazing how little literature there is out there, that we don't talk about it. But our bodies are important. They've been given to us as a gift, and it's important that we take care of them. And that doesn't mean, you know, any particular regimen is always 100% right for every person. No. But it begins with the question, what can I do, the little things, to honor the body God has given to me? Because we've been bought with a price, and you are not your own. You belong, body and soul, to Jesus Christ. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Gracious and loving God, thank you for the gift of our bodies. Some days we're content with them, often we are not. Many days they hurt. But Lord, what does it look like for us to begin to take care of our bodies? Each of us reflecting on the things we can do in our own life. Obviously, we all have genetics, and that plays a role. But Lord, what are the little things we can do? The habit stacking things? A short walk? Lifting weights, light weights with our arms for many repetitions? What are those things we can do to help our own bodies? And Lord, help us to understand where that fits in to us as an indweller of the Spirit in our lives, that the Spirit indwells within us. Lord, thank you. Thank you for our bodies that we often don't care for and wish it looked like somebody else's. But thank you for the bodies we have. We praise you this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, I invite you to stand as we share these words of the Apostles' Creed in the ancient form of the church. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Please be seated. Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. The Bible tells us that people will come from north, south, east, and west to eat at this table. Please know that all are welcome to this table. And as I say it every month, it is not my table. It is not the elders' table. It's not Church of the Master's table. It is Christ's table as he invites us to this banquet. And so we invoke his name as the host of this banquet. So let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Gracious and loving God, who sent your Son, Jesus Christ, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these, your gifts of bread and the cup, that the bread we break and the cup we bless would be your body and blood broken and poured out for us for the forgiveness of sins. Lord, when we eat of this, may we remember your sacrifice. And when we drink the cup, may we remember the sacrificial blood that was poured out. But, O God, we invoke your name as host of this banquet, that we are more than remembering this day, that you are present with us in a very unique way. Lord God, may your blessing be upon this table. May your blessing be upon the temples that are taking this communion this day. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. On the night of his arrest, Jesus, having taken the bread, blessed and broke it, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Eat of it in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant shed for the forgiveness of sins." That every time we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again in final victory. If you have your personal communion elements, the body of our Lord broken, take and eat. The cup of salvation, let us drink. Gracious and loving God, as you are broken and poured out for our transgressions, that we would have life, may we take the grace of this meal, that it would lead us forward into our lives, into the world, all as personal temples that the Holy Spirit indwells within, and we would be vessels and agents of your grace and reconciliation. We pray all this in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Friends, if you are able, I invite you to stand as we sing our final hymn this day, "Praise Ye the Lord, the Almighty." all of you beautiful little temples where the Spirit indwells, go out into this world knowing that you go nowhere by accident, but the call of God goes with each and every one of you. And may the love of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit go with each and every one of you both now and forevermore. Amen.